Is it the LeBlanc, as DeVicio said? Will it be the Lulu, as they had banned away in Game 1 and first picked in Game 2?
Could even be Elise, now that Flesh have revealed that they actually played a champion. Although Karsa, he found one opening, but didn't really return. Didn't really look impressive on that champion at all. Yeah, Flesh was actually saying, nope, we're done. Elise experiment.
Yeah, I literally think that was it. I think they were scared of Amazed Elise, and that was the main contributing factor to them trying to pick it away. And they kind of proved to themselves that Karsa is not as good on that champion as he is on something like Rek'Sai.
So, Gragas the Hover, though, it's weird that they are going to first pick this Rek'Sai since Amazing is happy to play that champion. But this looks like the exact same champion select as Game 1. In fact, I think even the bans are the same. We'll see if Amazing is going to go for the Gragas to the Lee Sin or something else entirely.
Where do they go for the Lee Sin here or the Gragas still? They have to be worried about the amount of peel that Sword Art and Karsa can produce. Because again, Jinx is open. Black Shield on Morgana if Sword Art goes for it. Later in these fights, we have a lot of these what they call blockers. If Flash Wolves do snowball their lead a little bit better, they can actually come into a very compromised position on the side of Origin right here. Because let's not forget, Origin, they did get that Penta kill on that Baron, but that could have played out a lot differently if Flash Wolves just played a little more respect to the speed with which Baron was taken by Origin.
Yeah, I do have to say though, like, the burden of adapting should fall on Flash Wolves here. Game 1 was so close, though, and Flash Wolves may feel like they kind of threw it away. We could see exactly the same team compositions.
And it wouldn't be all that bad for Flash Wolves, because remember, they had a winning bot lane in which they misplayed twice. They had a winning top lane that they couldn't snowball the advantage of because everybody else on the map was going down. But they still kept the game even for a tremendous amount of time while being down 3,000 gold due to the nature of those matchups. So if they don't make that mistake where they get double teleported the palm, they could actually lead in the early to mid game.
I think Flash Wolves may be setting up for their poke composition if they ran something similar against the Ku Tigers here. Normally they would have picked Jinx on this spot right there. They've shown the Morgana already.
Yeah.
NL's favorite champion, Varus, is available here. There's a chance they go for this different style. Down 0-2, maybe you change things up.
Yeah, especially with the pick order changing, it would signal that that would be the case for Flash Wolves.
Well, they're at least considering based on the rest of the picks coming through.
And honestly, Neil's picking Jinx here is very much like Karsa picking Elise in the last game. It's more of a denial pick than picking towards their strengths. However, Jinx is very good with Darius as far as chaining resets together and getting snowball fights.
And in terms of how they can round out the composition, Jinx Tahm Kench is a fantastic synergetic lane overall. You have double frontline here with Darius and Gragas that can peel. If they get through Tahm Kench, Darius, and Gragas, then Tahm Kench can simply just eat the Jinx anyways. And if you look at the combos they can do, you know, these stacks into stun, into traps, with Zap, there's so much outplay potential right here. And we've seen Mythia and Neils outperform Sword Art and NL, at least in the laning phase.
But is this enough engage if Flash Wolves does go for a poke team?
Nope, probably not. Unless we see the Abyssal Voyage flank putting Darius in the background, say, hey, I'm here.
What up? But really, it's the Gragas as the sole initiator against a Black Shield team.
Yeah.
As far as immediate initiation goes, so that's not the most.
Here's the Victor. Works both ways, and Caitlyn goes Caitlyn!
That's 70 unique champions here at Worlds. We were talking about Caitlyn before this match, but that was actually
very fond of this champion
for a different team matchup. But Freak, what are you fond about for Caitlyn here?
Caitlyn is a great AD carry, honestly. I think she just like fell under the radar for far too long, and just the fact that she is super consistent in lane. Honestly, her DPS is quite good in teamfights because her farm is so damn good. High range means high auto-attack uptime. She will be a damage source.
And this bot lane actually drastically outranges Tahm Kench and Jinx altogether, so they never even get into the position where they where this chain combo of, you know, eating somebody, putting him in the traps can even happen. Because even if you close the gap on the Caitlyn, she just 90 calibers nets out. They whittle away at you, and more importantly, like Clement pointed out on the Shox interview station, desk, whatever we're going to call it, they actually have a pushing bot lane right now if they so choose to, so they can finally channel that pressure from the bot lane into the mid lane and perhaps collapse on Xpeke.
I also feel like if he locks in this Orianna pick, last picking an Orianna I think gives very low amounts of value. It's typically a mid laner you can pick early in the draft and get your counter pick elsewhere, but because Origin power picked Darius early and then saw the Victor, like, there's not many surprises Origin pulled in this draft phase.
I mean, Origin, their composition, it's so clear what they want to do. They just want a long fight in which they just have so much zone from their front line and an Orianna ball in which Neils is the primary carry. he is just going to go untouched in this fight. And Flash Fills, while we talk about Origins engage being low, Flash Fills don't have any hard engage either. Gnar is generally a secondary engage where he collapses on an already rooted target. So we need to see Binding Land, knockup from Karsa, then stay going in. But Niels can definitely kite his way out of that. Worst case, Devour.
Yeah, and something we saw last game was Origin winning the lanes very substantially with beneficial matchups. This time, Flash Wolves has picked much better towards lanes.
Yeah, all
Caitlyn,
good.
Great laner. Gnar, counter matchup to the Darius. And Victor versus Orianna is a wave clear matchup, but Victor clears it faster. So yeah, every single situation for Flash Wolves is an advantage lane.
So we should see a lane swap.
That's what you'd expect.
Yeah. Well, we'll see if the lane swap does come through. You can see Stake on your screen there. His second Gnar game of this best of. In fact, his exact matchup was the best laning phase he's ever had at the World Championship so far, going equal to Soaz. We'll see if that trend continues. You guys know what time it is. Vote for who you think's going to win this one. Hashtag OG win for the red side. Hashtag FW win for the Flash Wolves here. And these guys are down 0-2 after making the top 8 here at the World Championship. For the Flash Wolves, to stay alive, they must win this game.
The one risk you run with playing pushing lanes is that you're very prone to getting teleported from behind. And again, Origin right here running double teleport, whereas Maple, again, with that Ghost Victor, had a lot of people tweet at me, he's like, you're wrong. The Abyssal build is very common. So apparently, has been played more. But
Abyssal's just common for mid laners who don't want to die in a heads-up matchup. I think pretty much every champion can buy that one as like a first major purchase.
I mean, yeah, the Abyssal build is very common in the sense of like, Victors do it sometimes. There are so many variations to the Victor build, whether you're Sorcerer Shoes, Cooldown Boots, Varela Nomicon early, Rush to Death Cap, Rush your upgrade on the Hex Core. Just a many, many options. So I got your back, Krupp.
Something we really need to track is the icon synergy. We haven't really seen the Penta icon come out either of these teams.
True. That's just bad discipline.
Yeah. You need a BM knowledge at the end. That's how you break their mental.
Beating them twice in the best of five in close games is enough to break their mental.
The icon
spamming
over
five
the
icons. Would have been over.
Then they actually just leave the venue and they, you know, two games is enough.
Walk away.
We don't need the third one anymore.
Well, if we're talking about quarterfinals in 2013, Flash Wolves was down 2-0 and then they had to leave the venue because it was just a best of three back then against SK Telecom. Now they get a chance to turn it around.
Alrighty. Well, you heard Clement say they did that recently against Taipei Assassin and IEM not too long ago. Maybe the reverse sweep does happen here for Flash Wolves.
All right, we have the makings of a lane swap right here. Mithy and Niels, they went to the top side. They're going to do their Krugs. Karsa, Stake, double jungling right here. Complete mirror lane swap. Initially, Caitlyn and Morgana are just very good at taking towers, but they're actually not that great at taking towers in a lane swap because Jinx actually does it better.
Yeah.
Just in a normal laning CG situation, Flash Wolves would have gotten a lot more out of those picks, so a lot of their advantages have been nullified by this lane swap.
I think it is one of the many reasons that Caitlyn has fallen off. While Caitlyn can still be great in pretty much every matchup, teams are so apt at just dodging the matchups now, and there are multiple AD carries who, like Tristana or Jinx, are better turret killers than Caitlyn.
And she has a bit of a lull in the mid lane. Granted, these teams play past that lull anyways. Caitlyn is incredibly good, I mean, level the first item, and then after three or four items, she starts racking up the damage, but in the mid-game, she actually struggles in a lot of the fights. Mostly because she brings almost no utility. Whereas if you look at Nielsen at Jinx, he can zap, trap, and have an AoE rocket.
Oh, early roam though, Sorta doesn't stay in the laning phase. Thanks to the lane swap, gets to go in and force the flash away from Xpeke.
Yeah, I like that roam in this lane swap because no one's really threatening a dive. A lot of the times, you're trading that mid lane pressure for a better or worse prep dive or protection, but both these teams are very clearly on the same page of double jungle, and it's a very low investment actually to get that flash out of Peke. The question will be this time whether or not they can actually punish it, because they got the flash out very early for Peke last game, and he was fine.
Amazing right now, setting up the Scuttle Crab. Stake gonna make sure that nothing is incorrect there, and Sword Art gets 15 gold for attacking the turret, and Flash Wolves are gonna be knocking this one down as fast as they can. Of course, the exact same thing is happening on the other side of the map with the Origin champions, so looks like the standard turret trade of the lane swap game.
Yeah, pretty standard trade here. Wave will eventually get bounced to the top laner. So is this a little low, though. So sometimes you've seen top laner just soak up his lane immediately. It looks like he'll bounce it and then base anyways. If he gets matched in the lane, he'll just get zoned off the wave.
Yeah, now the real choice will be who they leave for the turret gold.
Probably shared on Niels, because if you do it this quickly, he needs the share for the pickaxe. But it's actually...
Yeah, he'll have enough.
Yep.
Stake. This will be tenuous. I believe it will freeze because that 1 minion standing is actually the right way to do it. It builds the wave up so that reinforcements come from that side of the wave. So both these teams doing that play. Amazing comes into the mid lane to help Peke push the wave as Peke was he needs the help to make sure his first recall goes down all right. He's like right on Chalice money right now.
Yeah, NL didn't get that privilege from getting either enough CS or sharing the turret gold. He's down gold there, so he couldn't get his pickaxe early. Picked up an early Avarice right here.
Interestingly enough, it's something NL did in game one as well. He picked up a very early Avarice. That was a game where Niels was BF sword up until he obviously picked it up because he died in game one.
We see this a lot from the Korean players too. They just really like that early Avarice and they feel they can play in a pickaxe disadvantage, at least to wrap up more gold and get a more beneficial build. It also speeds up your third item. Jinxes generally don't want to go status shift if you can afford to go Phantom Dancer because it just brings you so much damage in teamfights. Whereas Caitlyn with the Siege Wave Clear type of style actually likes to shift because it speeds up your third item, makes you more relevant once you get the Lost Whisper.
And thinking from a gold perspective, Avarice Blade giving you 2 CS every 10, or 2 gold every time you get an extra CS. Every 10 CS is like 11 CS from a total gold perspective. He's pushed up real far.
The mid lane. Can Maple outplay? Pops Ghost early. Peke doesn't have mana. He actually didn't go for the TP play to get items and mana in, so chunked out low. Now he probably will leave the lane. Maple trades Ghost for not much.
Maple's been playing really well. That was just another example of having a lot of experience with Flash and Ghost. That's why he's not bringing Teleport. Victor with the Ghost gains a lot of advantages right there, the least of which being able to completely outrun a gank if it comes from that type of play.
Look at the kind of plays made here, though. Flash will dedicate all the members to the top lane to knock a turret down, whereas Origin had went for the mid lane gank. And now Zoaz not in a good spot. He's only level 3. The knockups come through. He has Flash. He'll use it if he needs to. Gets the heal enough and pulls Zoraida into the turret. The Flash auto gets his first blood. And now Zoraida flashes to the brush to trade one back. Bottom turret did go down, so that will be a trade of structures.
That was a really big outplay by Zoaz right there. You're thinking, why would he not just burn the Flash? It's a typical Zoaz greed play. So many times, but this time it worked. So many times we'll see him in a lane swap with poor vision because Origin actually doesn't place that many wards in the first 15 minutes. And he'll just kind of like walk up farther than he should because he really, really wants the CS and then he'll die. But this time he's doing exactly the same play and Flash was like, yeah, we got him.
But because
he's greedy with this Flash,
because he gets caught so often, he's actually gotten really proficient at turning it around, you know, using it in his favor. Good play there by Sword Art exhausting just enough to potentially force Soaz's Flash, but Soaz doesn't want to use it, and then he baits them in. They just forgot about the heal, and then he pulls in Karsa there, so fantastic outplay by Soaz.
It's like I forgot about a lot of things. Forgot about the heal, forgot about the apprehend, forgot about the turret.
See if Flash feels forgot about Drake.
No one forgets about Dre. Eminem has made sure that's never going to be the case. Stake, though, forgot about Mythi, and this couldn't be any worse for the Flash Wolves. Origin get the second kill.
Already down 2-0 in the series, and when the top laners do their trade back and Stake is trying to pick up experience, he falls. Luckily, he still does have his teleport, so when the wave does hit his turret, he'll be able to catch up, and now Soaz without Flash has to be able to defend himself as well. That's a 4-man dive, teleport as well.
Oh my gosh, here comes the team. Soaz, easy knockup, Sword Art pulls aggro.
Where's Tom
He's
though?
Gonna keep
what
it
this?
Up, and now there's the pullback. Mythi saves it for now, Stake on the backside. Soaz pushed pretty far, apprehends in, and here comes Gragas. Soaz still losing health, does not get the heal, and Karsa gets the kill. Now Mythi has to pop the shield, but exactly how far away can he really get? Couple more idols will do it, the Flash keeps him alive. NL has ulti, but not the mana to cast it, actually.
And again, this is the degree we're talking about. You were safe. Just walk away, Soaz. Enter the base. Just walk away.
Yeah, he was trying to turn that around for more kills. Mythi did save him from that turret, but one thing that happens here is the big minion wave that Stake was going to absorb on his second tier turret. He then goes for a plate, doesn't pick up much for himself. Still 0-1-1, and it's going to be a second turret trade, but importantly for Niels, huge gold income.
And remember what we talked about in Champs, like this entire composition is centered around Niels being the prime carry. Not only is he getting solo XP, he's getting solo gold in his turrets, he's getting comfortable position. Origin will now have to back out because they keep overextending on the weak side of the map. They want too much.
Origin getting punished for the greed here. Blue buff goes over to NL, and now Amazing has to be a bit careful. His Flash is already down, but Body Slam is back up. Nice dodge by Mythi. We sit at a basically...
Niels is playing PvE this game. Yeah, I don't think you've seen a single champion in the last like 5 minutes of this game.
I mean, sometimes you, as an AD carry, you look at your teammates and you hover around. You don't just lock camera killing CS.
Now he's pulling blue buff for Peke. Good guy, Niels.
Should have taken that. He deserved it. Did all the work. Screw you, mid laners. The only last hit. It's like they feel so good about themselves.
AD carries do more than this.
Will we see some Abyssal Dunkage, though, once SOAS hits level 6? Once the Tahm Kench ultimate is available from Mithy, drop the Darius in the backline. Dunk some people. Hit some resets. Double resets as well in these fights. So if one kill goes down, things can get bloody here.
I feel like that's going to be super dangerous to do against Maple, who's going with a different Victor build this time. Looks like he's going the Morellon Omicron route.
Yeah. Well, here we go. 300 gold difference. Mithy and Amazing trying to set up for the Dragon. Stake is top lane without teleport. He cannot join this battle. There's going to be no one defending this.
Yeah, you just see the difference in this Darius R matchup too. Stake stuck on the Wellflare build here. Gathering his mineral correction, two rubies, couple Thorns, but it's not that frozen mallet that we're used to seeing coming early in his game to really swing this 6 to 11 like part of the matchup here.
And it's really important to note that even though Origin is up 2-0 in this series, both of those games were incredibly competitive with Flash Wolves holding a gold advantage at some point very, very late into the game, and it just turned around on Origin having better late game shot calling and a few really big swingy moments in those games. So Flash Wolves very capable of still winning these games in this matchup. And this early game is, despite a couple two kills on each side, still a pretty low bloodiness game, as we are expecting from these teams.
Well, yeah, you can't get blood from a stone, so these turret kills not counting for that score.
Yes.
Very
nice. Nice pun.
Factual statement.
Yeah.
No, factual. But you see the difference here in approach too. SOAS pulling in stake here, hang on.
Ooh, good flash to follow. This is a bit greedy. I guess it trades flashes though.
Stake brings a ward. Maple brings a ward to the mid lane, but this is, we see very few side wards placed here by Origin. Very often it's just the trinkets at this point in the game. That's when they, even when they play a very stretch style, 1-3-1 split push all the time, they do have a tendency to get caught. Flash Wolves farm a little safer, so they get less CS, but they're less prone to getting caught out, so this could repeat itself, and the gold right now is even.
At the 15-minute mark, Origin has the fewest site wards placed of teams at Worlds at only 14, but the most yellow trinkets placed, so they're kind of trying to make up for it. You can see very late sweeper changes, especially from Amazing, and Amazing is also, as you mentioned in a previous game, the second slowest user to Sightstone, so it is a bit of a perpetuating problem since Origin wants to put so much pressure on these side lanes early on in the game, but really just don't have the ward coverage to do so, which makes them vulnerable to counterattacks. The question is whether or not Flash Wolves can actually counterattack them without vision.
And whether they have done their research preparing this, because very often when you see team split push, you assume at least a basis of wards. You think there's no way these guys are split pushing blind.
They do have two wards, at least in this split push. The question is how long will they be able to stay up and how adequately can they apply pressure?
It's interesting watching this bottom lane matchup because NL spent 1,000 gold on Berserker's Greaves, whereas Niels was a bit up in gold. You mentioned the solo farm, got the full BF sword here. So the movement speed disparity actually allows NL to pick fights a lot better. And you actually saw Niels getting chunked out by a couple of headshots.
Helps with the passive too overall.
Yeah. So watching how those fights can go, Niels has to be pretty afraid. Sword Art does have Moby Boots looking for the play.
Especially Niels is in trouble. Whenever Mithy leaves the lane, NL can just use his ultimate to poke. Because of the low amount of lifesteal that Niels has right now, only Doran's, probably not running any runes, he's just not going to be able to regen up overall. So just getting that poke out from NL kind of nullifies one side of the split push. Then you have, again, that winning matchup, Gnar into Darius, kind of delayed right now due to the lane swap on both sides, but it's still winning in terms of poke. That's nullified. So then you go to the mid lane, Wavekiller versus Leifgeir. Suddenly we have a slow game where not much is happening.
Definitely not a lot happening. 200 gold difference. Flash Wolves are actually the team with more gold. We talked about the solo farm that Jinx is getting. It's matched up now, of course, by NL.
I mean, both these teams generally behind, but can't both be behind in 20 minutes.
It's a paradox. They're both averaging in gold deficit. That will change.
Like ships passing in the night, a pair of docks.
Nice puns.
Thanks. Now you too can enjoy my puns, Britton. Enjoy. Did you really want it after all? Mithy trades wards with Maple. All is well here. Just simply not a lot going on between these two teams. A lot of turrets went down, which of course really affects how the map is played out. You've got a lot of long, wide open lanes. There's nowhere to run to if you get caught out. So as if he was somehow flanked, just wouldn't have anywhere to go. But of course, amazing. We'll have to bring a stake. Oh, misses the flash, but will still land the explosive cast into a perfect Desme into the dunk into amazing getting the kill.
Why is Stake crying? Because he just got dunked on. Probably don't know that reference.
Nope. No.
No. Just carry on.
Sorry.
Nice reference.
Someone will understand the reference, so congratulations. But as far as that gank goes, that was just Stake being up in a lane where his second turret was already dead. And it was that was kind of what Origin has been making mistakes doing for most of this world.
Yeah. Ooh, lands the damage. Neil's gotta be careful. The flash ulti and Mithy's consume is down right now. Sword Art will end the stun into Mithy. The binding hits Neil's. There's the Q. There's the kill. Mithy tried to flash consume, couldn't get it in time. And now Mithy has got nowhere to go. Eat some Organa, but to kill him in time before he digests.
And it's exactly what you were talking about, Chad. This is something Origin sometimes do. Especially once they have a kill made at one side of the map, they assume they're safe on the other side. They don't respect cross mapping very often.
Yep. And Karsa comes in at the very end of that one, but mainly it was just a good play by Sword Art and NL. They landed a couple nice headshots and ended up getting the edge. The binding into the finisher there, as Mithy tried to flash for the eat, really minute outplay, but it ends up costing basically two kills.
And more so, just the confidence. NL and Sword Art still have the synergy. If you make the play only when you really trust your support to land that skill shot, else you had both glowing flash there and you will just lose the all-in. So a lot of faith there from NL. He still had heal available just in case.
I guess we can see who all the CLG fans are rooting for now.
A lot of faith.
I got Come on, laugh I got my joke! Nice pun.
You get a nice chuckle there.
Mithy with the Ward of the Wall. Dragon comes up in only 20 seconds now. Origin did get the first. Game one was won largely, I think, off the back of the fact that they had so much Dragon control, it forced Flash Wolves into some awkward moves.
Turns out that Flash Wolves did, in fact, forget about Drake.
No, I got it the first time. Repeating jokes, the son of a bad caster.
The dragon's alive.
Let's talk about this dragon.
Yeah. Honestly, it's because Origin's in position for this dragon right now, and Stake just lost. Is he going to flash for the dunk attempt? It would have definitely pushed him back. Either way, Flash was very much on the defensive here, going down at least two dragons. This is eerily similar to game one, where even though Flash Wolves could come back with a few nice plays later, the dragon counter really was something that Origin could play around extremely well in game one.
They get the bonus stats from Dragon 1. They kill turrets faster from Dragon 2. Otherwise, the gold is the same between these two teams.
Origin just setting up for a fantastic late game here. Not only do they scale incredibly well on their mid laner six items, fantastic Orianna, Jinx, probably one of the better like six item carries with a Darius. Even if they get slightly behind in the late game, they have a 5-dragon win condition that they can always go through. They've shown the mastery of doing incredibly quick Barons under pressure. So Origin, they like these kind of close games where they can just outmaneuver you and out-shotcall you in the late game.
Yeah, as long as they don't make those big disastrous errors. But it's what we saw in the LGD versus KT matchup. Sometimes when one thing goes wrong for Origin, they're so quick to make a very aggressive play on the other side of the map that it can actually snowball against them because they miss both the plays, and before you know it, they're down 5,000 gold. But as of now, they're still up 2-0 with the very well-scaling team composition.
Yeah, patience is important. If you get picked off somewhere on the map, you gotta go in recovery mode. And a lot of teams actually try to chase a loss, and then you very often end up getting teleported to the pawn and getting outnumbered anyways. That's something we saw from Origin in some of their games. This time though, a little more patience here. Makes for a bit of a slower game. Leaves us with more time to talk about puns and the like.
Well, speaking of, both these teams
time talking about puns thus far.
Both these teams are cosplaying cosmetic surgeons in Los Angeles. A lot of patience.
Nice pun.
Stake
going in. Talk about something else.
What? Ooh, apprehend misses.
Yeah, I mean, Stake's frozen mallet is so delayed this game that Soaz still has a lot of presence on him on the side lane. When the frozen mallet completes, he should start losing some of that advantage. But because of how far he was put behind early, he's sitting on 1,400 gold as well as the Giant's Belt and Health Crystal, so it should be pretty soon that he gets Frozen Mallet completed.
But it just puts him behind in relative power to the other roles in the game too, right? Stake, usually once he gets ahead on that Gnar, he has a buffer. He has an amount of time that he can use to get in position for a Mega Gnar ulti. But right now, if he's this far behind in terms of build, he will just get blown up before he even gets there. That is the problem with playing in the R2 lane. So compared to Soas, he can't soak as much damage, but he's still a threat in terms of finishing people off, getting a double Q off, and then just resetting the axe swing there. So something you do have to be careful about.
Well, a couple of plays happening at once here for Origin. They're pushing mid. It's mainly because NL is bottom, so the top lane and mid lane pressure happen at the same time.
Wow, Stake really getting pushed around here. Black Cleaver done on Soas means the movement speed buff and the armor shred is going to be pretty important. Nice mechanical play, the Black Shield in time off the Shockwave. A couple of dodges on Dark Bindings, but Origin is getting very few attacks done on that turret, trying to break it down. Amazing will maybe get through this ward. Karse is coming.
Gotta play a little safe.
The one difference between the first matchup and probably the reason why this gold is so even is that we haven't seen any proactive teleport plays come out of Origin at all. They haven't really used it at all. Flash Wheel's not leaving any opening. Very reactive team. They don't really make the move first, and then Origin can't find an opening anywhere. Pick against Bound here, but third shot denied.
And Siege. This is actually really great for Mythy to be in the mid lane soaking up this experience right now, because you get a large bonus in experience when you're heavily behind the average level of the game. So Mythy being here as this extended push, even though he's been roaming a whole bunch, he was level 7, he was 2 levels behind Sword Art. The longer he stays in mid lane, picking up shares of these waves, the faster he's actually going to equalize the experience with really no full cost to it.
NL has been freezing it though, because every time we pan to the bot lane, the wave has been in the exact same location here. So Flash Wheel's taking a different approach. They don't want any kills, but they're not really dying anywhere. So they're saying, well, we can just deny one wave of farm or one lane of farm to Origin and actually out-CS them in this period.
Yeah. That's actually a really long freeze for NL. It's
been there a while.
A couple of minutes right here. And just now he's getting the CS back over Neil's, but that's huge because we know Caitlyn needs to hit about 4 items before
the relevance
kicks in.
And more importantly, it works because on the top lane, Stake isn't threatened at all because his towers are down anyway. There's nothing for him to lose there. Just lane control. And then Victor has been wave clearing significantly well with the backup from the Black Shield. Orange's only way to really break that open is a double prong dive in the mid lane where they go one left side, one right side, dive Maple, get him out of the equation, and then finish him off. They don't have the vision to really support that. Good pink wards on, on the sides here from Flash Wolves.
I also don't even know if they have the tankiness to do that yet. They don't actually have any armor itemization built up yet, so diving in between those two mid lane turrets would have been really dangerous. I have to commend Flash Wolves for that extended freeze in the bottom lane. They also ended the freeze right as the dragon's about to respawn.
Well, that's going to be the play then for Origin. They are trying to push the mid wave down, but it doesn't really seem to be happening, so if you can't kill off the base, bring the fight to you. The dragon doesn't really go anywhere. Doesn't really want to fly free, so they can just simply kill him where he lives.
They have to face check right now. The sacrifice you make of that play is that you obviously don't have any vision preemptively set up in the area that you want to contest, so you go for a bit of a crude face check, and that's exactly where Origin need to capitalize on the investment that Flash Wheel just made. You punish them right there. If you don't, then you just gave him single lane farm for free.
Well, all the single lanes. Origin farming as much as they can, putting a ring on their farm.
That was better.
Thanks.
How do you put a ring on a farm?
Slight improvement.
It's called a fence, so the cows can't leave.
Okay. Yeah. Jeez, Crippo.
Ever been to a farm? Come on.
I live on a farm. Horses, though. No cows.
They don't need fences?
They do, actually. A lot of fences.
How do you not know this? Meanwhile, the dragon is alive and maybe not for too much longer, though. Origin, though, losing a bit of control, and actually they're now down over 1,000 gold. Just 1,000 gold appeared out of nowhere from Flash, just slowly and surely gaining farm.
It's a minion power play.
Minions are worth a lot of gold. And if you're not taking any objectives while the other team is literally starving you of a full wave of minions, that's 1/3 of Origin's gold income as long as that was frozen. And Origin actually specializes in farming all three waves towards the mid game, so it's actually a great move by Flash Wolves.
Look at Snake.
Not to mention the frozen mallet. He has it right now.
He dodged two Qs so far.
Soas, he's going to have to flash to get away.
That one lands. Hyper's on again. Has the movement speed. There's the pull in. Soas will enrage. Doesn't land the Q though. Flash Wolves, Stake nearly gets him.
Great play there by Stake.
It was actually the moment he realized he wasn't getting ganked, but Soas was there alone. He kited him into the minion waves, let the minions help him, and just really good spacing. You want to stay out of apprehend, but in all attack range consistently. The one hop was slightly too far from Stake, but other than that, almost immaculate Gnar play here.
Yeah, the only improvement I feel like from Flash Wolves is they should have been doing the dragon while that Narplay was happening. Snake was only going to draw pressure up towards that top lane, and it was a perfect window for Flash Wolves to actually secure the dragon, even if Origin decided to counter. Oh,
good.
He's got him.
He's dead.
He's dead.
He's dead. There we go. NL gets the headshots, gets the kill.
And they can force Origin to rotate mid, then move into the dragon area safely. NL going for the duel here.
Well, no ulti means Neil's can feel a little bit more safe. The Q will not land, so it's gonna be okay. NL getting some turret shots in, though. This wave is not cleared all that fast. Amazing force back, and Peke's still dead for 20 seconds.
Such a nice fog play there by NL, standing right around the corner, and the long range of Caitlyn means Peke would have basically had to flash right away if he's anticipating the crits from NL. Obviously, you get a little bit lucky rolling those crits at this stage in the game. Surprised that they actually haven't gone straight for the dragon. They're trying to get even more power out of this play.
2 seconds left on Orianna. She does have teleport. Soaz gets pulled back, and actually a flash by Miffy. Very afraid of that fight in the first place. Maple still buying some time. Eats a chomper, though. This could be a bit of a risk.
Ooh.
Oh my god! Neil's nearly goes down, and a Meganar from State kills off Soaz.
There's no teleport from Expected to get behind the team, so that was just a bold defensive move by Origin and didn't work out there.
Yeah, and we know that Origin actually has pretty weak initiation. Flash Wolves keeping them basically at Caitlyn range the whole time, so they're not trading the damage, and it's allowing Flash Wolves to win these fights really substantially.
Yeah, look at that again, and this is what Flash Wolves do. They wait for a mistake.
Oh. Just such a nice play. Q into a crit, static shiv, into an ult. Peke couldn't have even flashed away from that.
And we may need to see that combo actually come out where Mithy uses Abyssal Voice to deliver his Beyblade Soaz to come into the back end of the fight, then keep them busy long enough for Origin to close the gap.
The thing is, unless Amazing is also closing at the same time, I don't see that play working very well because the Victor and Caitlyn could so effectively kite both of those guys when
walk
they come
away.
In. This is surprising though, the third dragon is going over.
Oh, no,
it's
not! Oh, amazing!
It is surprising indeed
early
that the third
smite.
Dragon is going to Flash Wolves. Yeah. The Prophet Zat returns.
So surprising.
The crystal ball.
That happened. Not your typical contest from Flash Wolves, but that is massive for this game because pretty much the only thing that Origin had going for them was the fact that they were going to be able to maneuver Flash Wolves around the map because of dragon pressure. Now it's kind of gone.
The turret's already gone. Look at that.
And third dragon means a lot, especially in these compositions where you want to close the gap. 6% move speed matters a lot. Dodging some of that Caitlyn damage, getting out of stakes, auto attack range, potentially maybe even getting somewhere in the fight.
But here we are in London where Flash Wolves are clearly minding the gap and keeping the range exactly as they need.
Yeah.
All right, I like that one.
And Neil's trying to contest his own red buff here. Karsa does not have smite. But NL gets the kill anyway.
Once again, Maple's going to be going for the Lich Bane build, which only makes it more punishing when Origin can't cleanly initiate. Watching this one more time, Amazing has Smite.
I mean, why?
Uses
he blows
it
up the barrel early and smites early. Yep. Oh, meanwhile, Peke looks for the play. Rocket lands. Has to get eaten up by Mithy to keep him alive. NL had to run away. Easy eat. Easy stop on this one.
I think that was a misclick from Karsa going into that portal.
Happens sometimes.
Water. Yeah, so us in the bot lane though, no punch.
Not completely sure what happened at the very start of that play, but the NL's flash was burned during that. He's becoming a pretty big threat. He's hit 3 of his major items.
And somehow NL ended up in melee range of Expeke, who was self-casting the ultimate. Without using flash. So something happened.
It wasn't a Gragas ultimate that sent him back in either. Truly outrageous.
Whoa. All right, he pops the shield. He should be okay with this one.
Soaz
finds Maple on the side. Decimate Ring hits as well. This is not a great sign for anyone as the health bars are dropping quickly. Stake buys a lot of time with a couple of stuns, but Soaz walks away. Maple runs for his life with a pull back in. Stake, he might be for dinner. No, walks away.
Maple just walks right out of that one. He gets to the inner ring of the Decimate from Garius, gets the move speed from his Q, and then just wanders away. He was dead to rights with that face check on Soaz, but miraculously escaped.
Yeah, really solid gravity field. Just fucked right before they had just the last bits of damage to take him down, and he walks out.
Yeah, Abyssal Void.
Ah, here we go.
That's how you get into melee range of Peke.
Good
nicely
flash.
Done. That's the Abyssal Void we may end up seeing from Origin. It could have been a Darius, but the Peke honestly worked decently well in that situation. Mm-hmm.
quick reaction, though. You saw Karsa immediately teleport to one of those Rek'Sai tunnels on the mid lane. Everyone roamed down as fast as they could. Both these teams pretty quick on the draw.
Yeah, if there's any lane that you're going to try and attack Flash Wolves in, mid lane is probably the one least favorable to do it because they're just so mid lane centric in their approach.
True. Well, we'll see what happens as Flash Wolves are trying to branch out towards this Baron area. They've already got a pick ward inside the Baron pit. They're trying to control top jungle as well.
Look at the timing on this siege. Look at bot lane right now. Origin is pinging already. They know that's a massive bot wave. So Origin might actually do what they call like a bit of a panic engage here to force a fight and then be able to go back and clean it out. Because if Flash Wolves play patiently here, they can force a really big siege and just wait for that bot lane to hit. But very often, teams make the mistake of overextending here. Origin going in.
That was the panic engage, but it didn't land. And now Soz would almost have to recall right now and then threaten with the teleport.
If they tried to use Abyssal Voyage, but ended up canceling it right there. But that's exactly what they're looking for because they're under so much pressure. And look at NL, split pushing in the mid lane right now. They're not committing on the top lane siege until that wave is hitting in the bottom.
Peke's got nowhere to go. He does have Flash, gets into the belly. Mithy's trying to run him out, but here comes Meganar! Pulls three of them back in, and they've already killed off the Catfish. There's a second one as well.
Yep, right as Soaz was sucked away to the bottom lane. So really smart knowledge of wave control by the Flash Wolves. Origin knew exactly what was up as well, but they just could not execute the defense. Now, they're going to desperately try and stop this Baron.
Here's the teleport in from Soaz, Peke.
Oh, stake is super low.
He's dead.
And he's dead, oh my god. And now Karsa's gotta be careful. Baron naturally plenty of damage. Niels maybe won't take it for himself. He goes in with Soaz. They gotta be careful.
The Baron!
Oh my god! NL getting more headshots than Scream, killing everybody.
Oh my lord. And you could see the hesitation on Soaz. He walked away from the Baron, then tried to get back again, but
Niels and NL had one thing on their mind, and it was killing the Baron right now. Completely game-defining moment right there. Origin had a desperation Baron in game one. This wasn't a desperation Baron, it was just a smart Baron by Flash Wolves. But chaos ensued, and Flash Wolves get a little lucky at Baron. Now they push into the base.
And amidst a storm of chaos, the Victor pushing into the mid lane. They're going to knock an inhibitor down at the very least and walk away.
But they forced that play with some fantastic textbook split push. Set up a six-man way, like a six-player worth of minions in the bot lane, slow pushing before you really commit to the top lane tower. We'll get to that later. Let's watch that fight again. Look exactly how Soaz is kind of confused at what's going on after stake drops.
Pretty big miscommunication once he drops because Flash Wolves gets so low. Karsa says, screw the Baron, I'm going out. But NL keeps hitting it, which makes the Baron a contested move. Niels tries to buffer the auto with the zap to make it a burst, but it sits at 60 health, which is easy pickings for NL. That's two times now Origin has tried to execute an objective and left it at sub 100 health, and then it's been taken by the Flash Wolves.
And we said the series was incredibly close. Either team could have won these first two games. Now we're seeing maybe the shoe on the other foot here. Flash Wolves with a sizable advantage. An inhibitor down, a Baron buff, and now Dragon number two.
Base isn't open yet, and if Flash Wolves commit to a five-man siege, we could still see Abyssal Voyage be used here offensively to just get somebody behind.
1 minute left on Baron.
But they can just storm the front right now.
Yeah.
Caitlyn is approaching maximum velocity. Three items done already, fourth one coming in.
Yeah, the damage out of NL right now, and honestly the damage out of Maple. With the Lich Bane, fully upgraded Hex Core, and a needlessly large rod already completed. Not to mention the 40% CDR build that comes out of Maple, so he's... It's very easy for him to kite, and it's very easy for him to consistently proc his Lich Bane on the backside.
And I really like what Flash is doing with Karsa right now. Going towards Titanic Hydra on Rek'Sai, being a split push threat. Again, it's a global champion, can jump to the tunnels. I really, really, really like this.
They're using what Origin is somewhat known for and using it against them. Origin had a heavy teamfight composition, actually weak at split pushing, and they're just split pushing against it. They're tearing them apart. Because that top lane tower, tier 2, it's gonna fall. And if Soaz commits, Maple can push in the mid lane and they can threaten the flank on the tier 3 here in the bot lane because it's really hard for Beckett to clear that.
And you can see top lane going down. Karsa tearing Origin apart like they're Tommy Wiseau. Turret number 7 goes down.
I think Flash Wolves, they're okay with this. They're just gathering gold and they're just gonna keep up the pressure in the deep vision and then default back to that dragon. Pick up their third one? Yeah, one of the game.
Currently sitting on two because of this deal. So the dragon snowball is not a very good win condition for Flash Wolves right now because it stretches the game really, really late and then makes the variation if they get caught in an Orianna Shockwave, like really high, considering they're at an 8,000 gold advantage right now. I think the main thing Flashers are going to try and do is just prep the waves and play the split push really well. They have the team composition to do so, and they've already done it a few times properly this game.
Yeah, and generally the only two times you get punished when split pushing is in the initial setup. If you're not in position to cross map while you're still setting up somebody's side wave, that's when an Origin can go aggressive. And at the very end, when you're actually sieging and you just overstep your bounds, you just gotta still play with respect. But if you can get that 1-3-1 done with all lanes pushing, it's so incredibly hard to fight against it because every counter move by Origin is incredibly telegraphed. If they randomly go show five people, well, they will engage on you or else they'll lose the half of their base.
And I'll also completed Bloodthirster, which is kind of the point of maximum power here for Caitlyn. One thing about Caitlyn as well is the fifth item can also be extremely offensive because she keeps so much range on the opponent. It's one of the big reasons late game Caitlyn can't be that effective.
Exactly why I like her so much. She can also do the Last Whisper of Thunder, which is a bit greedy because it's risky, but it's much more damage than BT for the gold.
It's exactly what Enno did this game.
If she's ahead of the curve in the game and she has a small gold lead, she's good. The problem with her very often is if she falls behind and still has to go into that third Last Whisper, then she starts struggling. But Clash Wheels did a fantastic job controlling that mid game, and yeah, that freeze, it paid off way back in around 20 minutes.
Being able to freeze the bottom lane for several minutes and not lose a single objective during, aside from all the other things that have happened, was kind of the defining strategic moment in this game.
Here we go.
Look at the damage.
Split from his team, chunking this turret down with the Dragon 2 buff, but he's got to be a bit careful. Black Shield gets broken. Amazing will not look for the explosive cast.
Look at how much faith he has in Sword Art. He just stands there. He knows he's going to get a Black Shield anyways. Worst case has Flash after it gets broken and takes that tower down on one single push.
Amazing could have guaranteed the kill though by either flashing or explosive cast, like flashing far enough behind that you couldn't flash that barrel away. Doesn't go for the play though, and NL stays safe because Black Shield got broken.
Yeah.
Pulls him over the wall.
Now he throws him.
Whoa.
NL just keeping so much distance. Stake working on the other side as well. Their desperation.
Finds a bit of an engage. Amazing at a half HP. Pulled right back over the wall by Mithy.
And when you see, when you're Flash Wheels right now, you're loving this because they're playing exactly into your hand. They're panic engaging because they know their inevitable doom will be upon them once this 1-3-1 is in. Yeah, phase 3 of the execution when you start whacking away at these inhibitors.
Look at this fight. Oh! Wow! Two crits!
Oh, that's deep.
Gets a little bit over aggressive, but it should be fine as they teleport in with the Meganar.
Not a chance at all. Inhibitor goes down. That's inhib number 2. Mithy forced to flash away the dark binding into the gravity well. They're going to retake the middle inhibitor. Flash rolls are so incredibly far ahead.
I just really love watching this style. Somebody take inhibitor. Yeah, just systematic destruction with no counterplay possible if you execute it right. Unless you start face checking here like Stakes, you'll have to flash over.
You will.
What?
Rocket comes out.
Whoop.
Body blocked by Sword Art. Good play there by the Morgana. Binding hits amazing. Will land a slowing barrel. His ulti is down anyway.
Missile Voyage.
Right onto a trap. Nice play by NL to set that one up.
Yeah, obviously aside from that misplay by Stake there where he's not punished, taking two inhibitors down, like, it's such a classic move. And both these teams are very experienced. Flash Wolves was in the quarterfinals, 4 out of 5 of their members as the Gamania Bears.
And I mean, SOAS and Xpekia, they should know the strategy because this is what they used to get to the World Finals or the World Championship in Season 3. This is a style of play that emerged in reaction to the very teamfight-heavy, long games that actually were common in Season 2. Split push and tearing people apart without actually forcing a fight and just systematically destroying the base, mostly with split push assassins back then, was their forte. Right now it's being used against them.
Well, honestly, as you were saying, one of the main ways you stop the split push is by hitting them during the setup. And that's why, that's kind of what Origin has tried to do. As they're pushing near the inhibitors, Origin's trying to engage on them before they make it to that point. They just haven't been executing. And it's a nice thing to see by Flash Wolves that they're playing so cleanly. Death cap completed as well on a Maple. This one may be over because now they're at the point of power that even a grouped up team fight, they can win handily.
Difficult situation then for Origin. They need some kind of miracle. 9,000 gold down. Down 7 kills, down 4 turrets, down 2 inhibitors. And here we'll see both Dragon and Baron up at the same time. We're gonna have Maple soloing the Dragon down towards the bottom of the map. There's the kill credit right there. Easy pickings for him. There's just too much control for the blue team. And at the same time, they're now starting up on Baron Nash. A Rek'Sai comes across the map. SOAS will have to summon her TP to join, but he TPs out
towards the
backside. And it's a much longer cooldown than Rek'Sai's ult.
I feel that's a very early TP from SOAS here. Maple walking in right now.
That's a big bind.
Mythia's still fairly tanky. Gets a shield from Orianna, walking away. Gray health on. Karsa is a legitimate damage threat. Is going for Black Cleaver next.
It's still worse in Flash's favor if you look at this entire play as a two-phase play. Phase one is you burn a teleport.
Yep.
Phase two is you actually set up the split push dangle for the Baron. Just skipping that though, they're actually making this to somewhat of a 50-50.
They kill the Baron so fast.
And they've got it already. Even though Snake is back to Minionar, he just jumps over the wall. All is well. No contest.
Yeah.
Baron to Flash Wolves.
Stake Meganard amazing away from the pit, so he couldn't make it over the wall. And they know that a four-item Caitlyn and a Lich Bane Victor at this point of the game can burst it down incredibly quickly. Just a smart play.
Keep jungle out of there. Screw phase two. Stake the Baron.
Only good things ahead there for Flash Wolves. 10,000 gold up, two inhibs down on a Baron. It's almost a formality now.
And yeah, out of all compositions, split push compositions get the most value out of a Baron and lose the hardest against the Baron. It is very binary in that regard because it just works so well both with and against of what they're doing. Right now they can 1-3-1. And Origin will need to start hitting them with an Abyssal Forge, potentially even at this point of the game, if they're this high in the lanes. That's what probably can't do, because here's Karsa.
Look how aggressive they are. Amazing, just takes far too much damage. The Bruiser Pain Drain of Stake and Karsa.
And that's about the worst thing that can have happened. You already have two ways of super minions, so your only way here is to force a fight on the 45. Third inhibitor. Now it's 4v5 and the main initiation is out. Flash Wolf's gonna push strong.
Easy turret kill, and now on to the third and final inhibitor. Flash Wolves backs against the wall. A big shockwave, but NL stays alive, gets away from the rocket. They didn't come out in time from Niels. That wasn't a call that came out. And Flash Wolves stay in the base. NL back to full health already.
Yeah, now Shockwave's down as well, plus a Baron-empowered Super Minion wave pushing in. This should be the final push.
And it's so frustrating to lose the game this way because you're not even entering a fight. Your base is just melting around you, and there's nothing you can do to stop it.
And here comes the final pushes. Turret still losing health. Shockwave down for another 30 seconds. Waves getting bigger and bigger. They're crashing against the shores of Origin's base. The Nexus now open. Amazing respawns. The fight to win the game. And again, it's no kills. It's just Flash Wolves taking game three.
Absolutely. When they needed to, they came out with the cleanest game yet. They actually had a small deficit in the early game, but through strong strategic play and just waiting for the Caitlyn and Victor to get strong, they outplayed Origin and came off with a very clean 41-minute victory.
All three squishies went deathless that game. Everyone who was ranged stayed out of the fire well enough. Despite a few cute plays by Origin, you had some flank Abyssal Voyages, you had some good Shockwave damage, but the three big carries and the Protector to keep those carries alive just got out of the fire every time.
Origin, you have to just critic them on what they did in the mid game right there. Mm-hmm. Allowing a team at this level of League of Legends to play 4v5 and not punishing them in any regard is a massive mistake. It's really hard to see the opening, but they even allowed Flash Wolves to maintain double pink ward around that mid lane to let the Victor aggressively move up and just wave clear after wave clear after wave clear, and it looks like they just forgot about NL farming in the bot lane.
Yeah, constant problem for Origin is their ability to make aggressive plays between 15 and 30 minutes, and that was the biggest toll we've seen so far in this series. Ends up in a Flash Wolves win.
And Origin trying to steal the Jinx away as though it was going to be a good strategy for them. Not a great one, not a great performance out of Niels either. 1-2-1, not a lot of damage on him. So Flash Wolves finally take a game. Maybe they can get two more and win this series. But for some more insight on that match, going to